Well, good morning and welcome to church. It feels like most of us are here. And after so many weeks of the flu and then COVID, taking this person and that person away from church, it's good to see so many of us. And we're here to worship the risen Lord Jesus. Before we begin, I would like to say something about Queen Elizabeth II. It feels like everything that could be said has been said, but I'm going to squeeze in a little bit more. And that is to say, she was, by title, the defender of the faith. She was not the head of the Anglican Church, because that's Jesus, but she was the governor of the Anglican Church, by title. But more than that, she professed the faith in Jesus. And so many times in Christmas messages and in messages that required a word of hope, she directed us to Jesus. So this is what I'd like to add. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is in the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labour in the Lord is not in vain. And can't we just sort of wrap that great confidence around Queen Elizabeth and remember her life? We're also going to listen to just a tribute that the Archbishop is going to bring.
Here in my office is the chair on which Archbishop Howard Mole sat when he attended the coronation of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth in 1953. And now the long reign of Queen Elizabeth II has come to an end. Throughout that time, in Anglican churches, we've prayed for her weekly. And today we give thanks to God for her long reign of dignity and grace, of humble and unstinting service, motivated by her deep and enduring Christian faith. We pray for King Charles III and for the royal family in their grief, that they would be comforted by the sure hope we have in the death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, the hope in Jesus to which Her Majesty held throughout her life. As we thank God for the life and faith of Her Majesty the Queen, let us pray too that many others may discover the hope that we have found in Jesus.
And we will pray a little later for King Charles III, that he might follow in his mother's footsteps. Let's begin our time, as we've sung the glories of Calvary, to think about who we are as people who stand in the cross and all that Jesus accomplished, but also reminded that day to day, hour by hour, we still sin. So I'm going to give you a moment to bring your heart before God for just a minute, and then we'll say a word of confession. And together, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for forgiveness through Jesus and new life by the Spirit. Forgive us when we've been slow to accept rebukes and nursed regrets, self-pity and resentment, rather than being content with you and the life you have given us, loving you, trusting you, thanking you. We turn from our sins and ask you to cleanse us and fill us that we might live as your people of grace. And reminded of what Jesus has accomplished at Calvary, having been buried with him in baptism and raised with him through your faith in the power of God who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. And then it's that great confidence that we do stand. Well, kids, it's time to you to go out to your program. Hands up, kids. Who's here this morning? Wow, who's looking forward to it, your time with your leaders? Yes? All right, I'm going to pray. Our Father, we thank you for these kids, and we pray that today they would take another step on their journey of faith in Jesus. We pray that you'd be with their teachers, and we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, kids, we will see you a bit later this morning. And for the rest of us, why don't we take the moment to say hi? Just as you're coming back to your seats, a couple of announcements. As you came in, hopefully you received a little flyer about the church camp. And for those of you who are already committed and coming along, it's got a little bit of what our program will be like. But for those of you who are still a little uncommitted, please think about either coming for the weekend or part of the weekend. So you've got a week to work on that. And the other thing to say is we've had a really difficult time pulling together a children's team. So, parents, we are going to have to draw on you for one session to help with kids. And others who haven't decided to come down, you may well decide to come down simply to help with the children's program. And that would be a great way to serve. But for everybody else who is staying behind next Sunday, now hear this clearly, there is a one combined service and it will be at 9:30. So forget all the regular times, one service on Sunday back here, 9:30, and Anthony Douglas, who some of us know from Shoalhaven Heads, will be leading that service. We're going to come into a time of prayer now. And Michelle is going to lead us.
Let's pray together. Father God, thank you that we are your people, the sheep of your pasture, and that you provide for all our needs, both great and small. May we bring before you the concerns of our hearts, casting our cares upon you and knowing that you care for us. We especially pray for the royal family at this time of great sadness with the recent death of our Queen, Elizabeth II. Comfort and encourage them all as they reflect on the remarkable legacy of her life. And particularly, we ask that by your Holy Spirit, you will inspire our new King, Charles III, to walk in your ways and be guided by your word at all times. We ask that your kingdom will come and your will be done throughout your universal church. May we be generous in our prayers, energy, and financial support for Christian ministries worldwide, so that many will hear the gospel of truth and turn to faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Help us to be responsive to the promptings of your Holy Spirit to share our faith with others around us day by day and to love them with your love. We ask that you will enable people of faith to freely express their beliefs publicly in our nation and for wise and just laws in Australia that protect freedoms of speech, belief, and association. We especially lift up to you our brothers and sisters in Christ who risk their lives daily to live out their faith in nations that despise your word. Preserve their lives, Lord, and give them boldness, wisdom, and provision for their needs as they continue to walk with you and share their faith with others, despite the dangers involved. Lord, we pray for your blessings on all those in our church and community who struggle with mental health issues and the long-term impacts of trauma. May they receive skilled and compassionate support from those trained in these areas, and most of all, find healing of body, soul, and spirit as they are united with Christ. We especially ask you to bless the chaplains who work locally in our prison, courthouse, hospitals, nursing homes, and schools. May they grow in their personal knowledge and love of you, and share your gospel of hope, peace, and salvation with those with whom they connect. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to bless all the members of our church here at All Saints. We ask especially that you will guide those involved in our children's and youth ministries on Sundays, as well as Blast and Rev 21 on weeknights. Raise up the volunteers needed to run these ministries well and enable true evangelism and discipleship to occur through these fellowships. We also pray that you'll provide a new youth leader in a timely way to assist in this work at All Saints. Finally, Lord, we acknowledge that without you, we can do nothing. May we prioritise the time we give to our personal devotions and prayers, encouraging one another daily to persevere in our faith and not become hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. May we abide in Christ and bear fruit for his kingdom so that he will be glorified in our lives more and more. We ask all these things in his precious name. Amen.
Good morning. The first reading that we have this morning is from Luke chapter 22, verses 39 to 53. Luke 22, verse 39. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and prayed. Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray so that you will not fall into temptation." While he was still speaking, a crowd came up, and the man who was called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus asked him, "Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?" When Jesus' followers saw that what was going to happen, they said, "Lord, should we strike with our swords?" And one of them struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his right ear. But Jesus answered, No more of this, and he touched the man's ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple guard, and the elders who had come for him, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come with swords and clubs? Every day I was with you in the temple courts, and you did not lay a hand on me. But this is your hour when the darkness reigns."
Please join us singing "How Great Thou Art."
Lord, my God, when I hear not
take a seat. Now, Ruz, we're about to hear part two of the reading of last week, which was Absalom and David, David's son, and we just left off with the hearts of the people are with Absalom. So, just very briefly, what would you like us to keep an eye out for, especially during the reading?
Yes, as we look at 2 Samuel 15 this morning, I'd like you to pay attention to the details of the different places that the narrative takes us.
That simple?
Yeah,
little geography
simple.
Thing.
Just geography, the different places in this story, as we have this read out soon, just the different places that David goes to along the way.
Yeah, I know where you're going with this, and it is quite powerful. So let's hear from God's word.
Reading from 2 Samuel, chapter 8, from 13 to verse 37. Chapter 15. A messenger came and told David, "The hearts of Israel are with Absalom." Then David said to all his officials who were with him in Jerusalem, "Come, we must flee, or none of us will escape from Absalom. We must leave immediately, or he'll move quickly to overtake us and bring ruin upon us and put the city to the sword." The king's officials answered him, "Your servants are ready to do whatever our lord the king chooses." The king set out, with his entire household following him, but he left 10 concubines to take care of the palace. So the king set out, with all the people following him, and they halted at a place some distance away. All his men marched past him, along with the Kerethites and Pelethites, and all the 600 Gittites who accompanied him from Gath marched before the king. The king said to Ittai the Gittite, "Why should you come along with us? Go back and stay with King Absalom. You are a foreigner, an exile from your homeland. You came only yesterday, and today, shall I make you wander about with us when I do not know where I'm going? Go back and take your countrymen. My kindness and faithfulness be with you." But Ittai replied to the king, "As surely as the Lord lives, and as my lord the king lives, wherever my lord the king may be, whether it means life or death, there will your servant be." David said to Ittai, "Go ahead, march on." So Ittai the Gittite marched on with all his men and the families that were with him. The whole countryside wept aloud as the people passed by. The king also crossed the Kidron Valley, and all the people moved on towards the desert. Zadok was there too, and all the Levites who were with him were carrying the Ark of the Covenant of God. They set down the Ark of God, and Abiathar offered sacrifices until all the people had finished leaving the city. Then the king said to Zadok, "Take the Ark of God back into the city. If I find favour in the Lord's eyes, he will bring me back and let me see it and his dwelling place. But if he says, 'I'm not pleased with you,' then I am ready. Let him do to me whatever seems good to him." The king also said to Zadok the priest, "Aren't you a seer? Go back to the city in peace with your son Ahimaaz and Jonathan, son of Abiathar. You and Abiathar, take your two sons with you. I will wait at the fords in the desert until word comes from you to inform me." So Zadok and Abiathar took the Ark of God back to Jerusalem and stayed there. But David continued up the Mount of Olives weeping as he went. His head was covered and he was barefoot. All the people with him covered their heads too and were weeping as they went up. Now David had been told, Ahithophel is among the conspirators with Absalom. So David prayed, O Lord, turn Ahithophel's counsel into foolishness. When David arrived at the summit where people used to worship God, Hushai the Archite was there to meet him, his robe torn and dust on his head. David said to him, If you go with me, you will be a burden to me. But if you return to the city and say to Absalom, I will be your servant, O king. I was your father's servant in the past, but now I will be your servant. Then you can help me by frustrating Ahithophel's advice. Won't the priests Zadok and Abiathar be there with you? Tell them anything you hear in the king's palace. Their two sons, Ahimaaz, son of Zadok, and Jonathan, son of Abiathar, are there with them. Send them to me with anything you hear. So David's friend Hushai arrived at Jerusalem as Absalom was entering the city.
Well, good morning again. It'd be great if you kept your Bibles open there to 2 Samuel 15. And coming up on the screen is an outline of where we're going this morning. So if you take notes, you might find that helpful for you as we dig into this part of Scripture. But first, let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that even though we are reading about events that happened many years ago, that they are relevant to us today as we live for the Lord Jesus. And Father, please help us this morning as we come to your word, that we will have hearts ready to be transformed and changed to live for our Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, as Jeff mentioned at the start, we've all taken in the news over the past few days from the UK with the death of the Queen. And it's a moment of collective grief and sadness for all of us after the death of a remarkable woman, a remarkable leader, and a remarkable sister in Christ. And it's such a low point for a nation and for a lot of people, a low point on such a grand scale. Even for us down here in Australia, we seem to be so distant, and yet we are hit by it as well. But of course, we all personally have low points in our life that aren't so distant. We personally experience those dark hours and moments, the loss of those near and dear to us, major disappointments and heartache, tense and broken relationships with others, pain, both physical and emotional, and moments of high stress and exhaustion. Maybe some of those things describe where you're at right now, that you feel like you're walking through a valley or a dark tunnel where you can't see any light. So how do you get by in your darkest hour? What do you do? Do you have someone who you turn to? Perhaps it's a spouse or a close friend. Is there a place that you like to escape to get away from everything? A happy place. Is there an activity that you like to do to distract yourself from the pain and everything else? Do you have a comfort food that you indulge in? A block of chocolate? A tub of ice cream? Or maybe even alcohol. See, when I had a bad day, what I used to do was I'd come home and I'd put on an episode of Fawlty Towers, the British sitcom. My thinking was, that even though I've had a bad day, it could be a whole lot worse. I would have a laugh and relativize the bad days. That was my way of coping in my darkest hour. You see, there are many things or people that we might turn to in our darkest hour, when we are at our lowest. But as followers of Jesus, we know that he makes a difference to how we respond during those dark moments. We know that Jesus has conquered evil. He is powerful over our fears and failures. And in our trials and hardship, we aren't walking alone because he is with us. He knows what it's like to experience those dark and painful moments. Jesus has walked that road too, and he is able to sympathize with us. We can turn to Jesus in our darkest hour. In our first Bible reading from Luke 22 before, we saw the darkest hour and moment of Jesus' life in those 24 hours before he died. The moment when Jesus was in great sorrow and despair at what would await him at the cross. He prayed, "Father, take this cup from me, yet not my will but yours be done." He would go on and be betrayed by one of his closest friends. And on the cross, he would bear the sins of the world. It was a dark hour for Jesus as he went to the cross. And it was a dark hour for the world as the Son of God was crucified and put to death. But 1,000 years before that darkest hour of Jesus, another man experienced his darkest hour. He walked that same road as Jesus did, quite literally. He wept and cried out to God in that moment. He cast himself on God's mercy. King David experienced his darkest hour. And what David did during his darkest hour would point to what Jesus did in his darkest hour. And this gives us comfort for when we are in our darkest hour. But first, if we have a look at 2 Samuel chapter 15, we see David's darkest hour right here. And to be fair, you could say that David's darkest hour has been more like David's darkest years after everything we've seen over the past few chapters in 2 Samuel. That everything has been gloomy and chaotic ever since that one act from David of committing adultery. And we've sat in that space for the past couple of weeks. But here in chapter 15, things ramp up again. As we saw briefly last week, David's son Absalom has rebelled against him. He's desired to be king instead of David. And so he started to behave like a king. And now he has taken the throne for himself. He has taken Israel away from God's anointed king, David. And this leads to more grief and carnage. What Absalom does is a walking description of what sin looks like. When we sin, we put ourselves on the throne in place of God. We behave like we're the ones in charge. What Absalom does is a description of how we treat the one true king. And as we've seen over the past few weeks, when it comes to sin, there are no winners. When we sin, it has devastating consequences. And that's what we see with Absalom in the first bit of this chapter. And so the news of Absalom's rebellion, it reaches David. In verse 13, a messenger came and told David, "The hearts of the men of Israel are with Absalom." And with those words, David is plunged into his darkest hour. David and his household and the people of Jerusalem, they are fleeing for their life. Absalom's going to put the city to the sword. That's how stark it is, life and death. And so David jumps into action straight away. He decides to get out of there. He acts swiftly and decisively. And I bet some of you are thinking, where's that been over the past few chapters? Where was David being decisive when he needed to? Where was David being decisive when he needed to deal with Amnon? But now he's on the run, fleeing for his life. And what David is experiencing here is the experience of too many people across our world today. Refugees who have to flee their home country for the sake of their life, often leaving with the clothes on their back, and that's it. It's a dark hour for David. He's fleeing for survival. And for him personally, his own son wants him dead. For him physically, he's being displaced with nowhere to lay his head. And for him, he, as the king, he's now on the run. Far from this picture of him being this successful conquering king, it's a dark hour for David. And it's a dark hour for everyone with David. All the people marching out with David are weeping and crying. It's a tragedy for God's people. And we see this at the end of verse 23 in a very small detail there. That David and the people are heading out from Jerusalem towards the desert or the wilderness. What we're seeing here is a complete reversal of everything that David's experienced so far. Earlier in 2 Samuel, David entered Jerusalem. He marched in victoriously, having defeated his enemies. He brings the Ark of God into the holy city. He leads a procession of singing and dancing and celebrating. There was much joy all round. But now David's leaving the city. He's marching out of Jerusalem, fleeing for his life. There's no joy or celebration, but there's weeping and sorrow instead. And the Ark of God is being carried out of Jerusalem. And worse still, they're heading towards the wilderness. In the history of God's people of Israel, they have been brought out of the wilderness and into the promised land and up to Jerusalem, the holy city. But now they're leaving Jerusalem and heading back towards the wilderness. It's as if someone has clicked undo or rewind on the history of God's people. They're going backwards. They're regressing. It's a dark hour for God's people. It's a dark hour for God's king. And we see that in David's darkest hour, his route takes him across the Kidron Valley, the same route that his greater son would take 1,000 years later in his darkest hour. So what David does in his darkest hour, it points to what Jesus did in his darkest hour. As we look at David, we can see these same footsteps that Jesus would take. And this helps us know how we should respond in our darkest hour. So in these next few minutes, I want to highlight three responses that we see during David's darkest hour. And the first is that David grieved. During David's darkest hour, he grieved what he was going through. He was engulfed in the sorrow of having his own son come after him. At his lowest, David wept and cried, overcome by the terrible and traumatic events that he was facing. You see, in this moment, David faced up to the reality of his situation. This wasn't fun and games. He didn't try to deny or suppress the sorrow of all this. He didn't try to relativize it or laugh it off. No, David grieved the terrible events that he was going through. And David led his people in their grief as well. That's what we see as he climbed the Mount of Olives. David led the people in their grief and mourning. And again, this would be the same route that his greater son would take 1,000 years later. Jesus too would climb the Mount of Olives and be brought to tears by the terrible events that he would go through, by being betrayed and crucified. But amidst this grief, what we see with both David and Jesus is uniquely comforting. In this moment, we see God's king overcome with sorrow and brought to tears. It's one of the unique things about Christianity that we have a God and a king who grieves and leads us in our grief. Our God grieves with us because he has entered our broken and dark world. In his Son, he's experienced the pain and sorrow and suffering of life on planet Earth. So God is not distant in our darkest hour. He knows what it's like. Jesus has walked that road, and he's walking with us on that road, leading us in our grief and pain. And that's such a great comfort, especially when we're feeling low, that our King is walking with us. He knows what it's like. So in the midst of our sorrow and pain, it is right and proper for us to grieve. As Ecclesiastes tells us, there's a time and a season for everything. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. So in our darkest hour, it is right for us to grieve. It's right and proper for us to cry. Yes, us men can cry too. It's okay. It's right for us to sit in our sorrow, to not try and escape it or smooth it over. It's okay for us to feel sad about things. That's what we see with David. That's what we see with Jesus. So as a church, we are a grieving community. While we rejoice with those who rejoice, we also weep with those who weep. We are a community who grieve together and carry one another's burdens. We are a community who grieve our sin and the way it displeases God. And we are a people who can show the world how to grieve with hope. Our Lord Jesus, he grieves in his darkest hour, and he leads us in our grief as we grieve with hope. And in David's darkest hour, we also see him surrendering. The most profound thing, the most profound way that David responds in his darkest hour is that he surrenders. But he doesn't surrender to Absalom. He surrenders to God. In his darkest hour, David surrenders all control or any idea that he's having control of things to God. David casts himself on the sovereign God and his mercy. And we see this in David's little interaction with Zadok the priest. If you look down from verse 25, David says to Zadok there, "Take the ark of God back into the city. If I find favor in the Lord's eyes, he will bring me back and let me see it and his dwelling place again. But if he says, 'I am not pleased with you,' then I am ready. Let him do to me whatever seems good to him." See, David tells Zadok to take the ark back to Jerusalem. And what we see here is that David's not trying to pretend that he's in control. He's not trying to use the ark of God superstitiously or as some kind of charm to manipulate or control God. No, David knows that God is sovereign. In his darkest hour, David is saying, "Lord, I'm not the one calling the shots here. You are. So do as you please." David surrenders everything over to God. Another way that you might describe what David is doing is faith. As David surrenders to God, it's faith. It's an expression of trust in God. David's depending on God and his good and sovereign will in all situations. He's entrusting himself and his situation to the Lord, no matter how bad it is, especially when it's quite overwhelming for him. And you get the sense here that David is at peace with this. Even though he's going through his darkest hour, he is at peace knowing that God is sovereign, that God's in control of all events, however they may pan out. And you can't help but hear echoes of the Lord Jesus here. "Father, not my will be done, but yours." And so this is a model for us. When we're in the midst of our darkest hour, that we entrust ourselves and our situation to the Lord who is sovereign over all. You see, quite often we deceive ourselves by thinking that we're in control of events, but we're not. You would have thought the last couple of years would have taught us that. But how quickly are we to forget? We are not in control. And so during our darkest moments, during all the moments of our life, it's time to surrender. A time to pray and entrust ourselves to God, who is sovereign over all. To cast ourselves on His mercy and goodness. To pray, Lord, I'm not the one calling the shots here. You are. But you see, as we pray and as we surrender, it doesn't lead us to be passive or paralyzed. Surrendering to God's sovereignty doesn't mean that we do nothing. See, in this chapter, David entrusts himself to God and His mercy, but he doesn't sit back and do nothing. He gets on with living obediently and faithfully. He goes ahead and makes plans. We see there that he's fighting for his own survival. But he does this knowing that God is sovereign and will do whatever seems good to him. Not because David's in control of events. No, no, no. He knows that God is sovereign. So this means we surrender everything to God. Our lives, our circumstances, our feelings, our worries, our concerns. We entrust everything to God knowing that He is sovereign and that we're not. And so we get on with living faithfully and obediently to Him, wherever that may lead. And finally, in our darkest hour, we are to respond by following the King, wherever this may lead. And we see this in the example of Ittai the Gittite. Now, we skipped over this before, but in your Bibles, if you have a look down at verse 19, as David is fleeing and leaving Jerusalem, he comes across this man Ittai and 600 Gittites. Now, these guys are foreigners who are living in Jerusalem, just minding their own business. They were from Gath, the hometown of Goliath, the giant who David slayed. And David says to Ittai, and I'm paraphrasing here, why are you guys marching out with me? You're not Israelites, just stay behind here. You're going to be safe with Absalom. In fact, why would you leave the safety and comfort of Jerusalem and go on the run with me? But Ittai says to David there in verse 21, as surely as the Lord lives, and as my Lord the King lives, wherever my Lord the King may be, whether it means life or death, there will your servant be. Ittai is saying, David, I'm with you. I'm with you every step of the way, even if it means death. Ittai goes all in with God's King. He's not having an each-way bet here, sitting on the fence. He doesn't say to David, oh, look, I'll come with you part of the way, and if it gets hard, I'll turn back to Jerusalem. No. In his darkest hour, he's all in with the King. He doubles down on following David, even though things look uncertain, sketchy, and just out of control. And here, Ittai shows us what Christian discipleship looks like. That when you know who the King is, you will follow Him wherever He goes. And that's especially true when we are in our darkest hour, that we follow Jesus wherever He may lead us, whether it means life or death. And we do this knowing that He is with us wherever we go. You see, sometimes when things get hard and difficult for us, we can think that that's the time to pull back and take the foot off. That when things seem to be spinning out of our control, that that's the time to not be as full on with the Jesus stuff. But you see, in our darkest hour and in those hard times, that's when we need to be following the King. That's when we need to be going deeper with Jesus and depending on Him. That's when we need to be hearing the voice of our good shepherd to lead and guide us. That's when we need to be investing in Christian community and one another, encouraging each other and not withdrawing. In our darkest moments, that's when we need to go all in with the King. When David was in his darkest hour, he drew near to God. When Jesus was in his darkest hour, he drew near to God. And so when we're in our darkest hour, we must draw near to God and his King Jesus. We go with the King wherever he goes. We go the way of Jesus, even when it's difficult. Whether it's life or death, we go wherever he goes. And of course we do that knowing his promise that he is with us wherever we go. So in our darkest hour, we follow our King, the Lord Jesus. What we see with David in his darkest hour points to Jesus and his darkest hour when he went to the cross. And we take comfort knowing that Jesus has gone before us and that he is with us in our darkest hour. And so this is where we leave things in 2 Samuel for this year. And next year we're hopefully going to pick it up again. But this is where we leave things. With David in his darkest hour. On the run from his son Absalom, who's seeking to take the throne. But one thing is for sure. There can't be two kings over God's people. There can't be two kings sitting on the throne. So you can read ahead to find out what happens. Or wait till next year and find out then. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for sending your son Jesus. We thank you that in his darkest hour, he called out to you. And Father, we pray that like him, we will call out to you, our Heavenly Father, at all times, especially in our darkest hour. And we pray this for Jesus' sake and glory. Amen.
We're now going to sing I Will Trust My Saviour Jesus, and this will be our offertory song.
Trust him when to
it is a beautiful spring day, and I hope you have a great day as you go out. I hope you stay a little longer and share a cup of coffee and encourage people around you. But if you are going out into a week of harder things, remember Jesus has gone before us in our grief, and he can be trusted.